Good evening, everybody.
Hello.
Thank you. Hello. Thank you so much for jumping on Zoom tonight for this Zoom version of a fond farewell, talking about how we can navigate a healthy pastoral transition. My name is Annie Rose, and I'm very delighted to be with you all tonight. We'll see if we have some more friends join us as we get rolling along here. Just one kind of programming note as we get started. One difference between doing this session on Zoom versus doing it live at GA is that this session is being recorded so that it can be distributed later on to people who weren't able to come. So that's just something to keep in mind, especially when we get to our question and response time. We are recording this and we'll be sharing it so that others can benefit from our conversation together tonight. So with that, I would just like to open us in prayer and then we'll dive into this topic. So please join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we confess that you are the Lord of the church. You are the head of the body. You are the bridegroom. And everything we do is meant to bring you glory and to prepare us, your people, to receive you when you return. So we ask for your Holy Spirit to be with us tonight as we talk about transition. We pray that whether we are pastors or elders, whether transition is something we're contemplating or we have already worked through, that our time together would be for the good and for the equipping of your body, and that it would bring you joy to see the way that we encourage one another and strengthen one another. So be with us, guide us. Fill us with your wisdom, and we praise you and thank you for your love. It's in your name that we pray, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
So hopefully, if you received my email with the link for this meeting, hopefully you also received a copy of the document entitled A Fond Farewell. Great. This document contains some guidelines that our Ministerial Vocation Committee has been developing to assist our churches in preparing to go through pastoral transition, leadership transition. And it's a working document. It's something that the MVC has been working with for almost a year now. And one of the things that we were grateful to do as we presented this material is to hear feedback from people. We really want to hear interaction from folks on the ground, so that we can continue to refine and improve these guidelines for the good of the church. So these are guidelines, they're not mandates. And this is something that we are continuing to revisit and improve. So even our time together tonight is gonna be very helpful to us in continuing to guide and direct our churches through transition. So as we start with this topic, I think it's important for us to acknowledge that transition is difficult. Pastors pour their heart and soul into their ministries, and it is very challenging after spending years in a place and building relationships of trust with people to have to let go and say goodbye. It's hard on both sides. It's hard for the pastor and the pastor's family, and it's hard for the congregation. And so we need to acknowledge that. We need to acknowledge the grief that comes with transition. And we need to extend empathy to one another as we walk through these times of change. But with that said, we have to continually come back to the realization that it's very important for us to navigate these times of transition well for the health and well-being of the church. And I would highlight one of the statements at the end of the first paragraph on our fond farewell document, where it says, a successful transition depends on the mature preparation of the pastor, the session, and the congregation. The mature preparation of the pastor, the session, and the congregation. Every single person is going to be impacted by a leadership transition in a church, and every single person has a role to play in making that transition a successful and healthy one. And you can read more about that towards the end of page one, how We really see that each person involved has a specific part that they're called to play for the good of the church. But the three values that we really want to emphasize with these guidelines are highlighted in those bullet points on page one: intentionality, collaboration, and clear communication. Intentionality. Again, transition is difficult. It's hard to say goodbye. It's hard to let go. Even when you're optimistic about what God has in your future. And so it's important to approach a time of transition with intentionality, with purpose, not simply waiting until the last minute to make difficult decisions. So we really emphasize the fact that pastors and sessions need to be proactive in planning for transition. And once a pastor has realized that he or she is going to be moving on, we strongly encourage the pastor to, as soon as possible, begin working with their session on a transition plan. And that brings us to our second value, which is collaboration. You notice that I said that once a pastor realizes they're going to be going through transition, they need to work with the session. Both the pastor and the session need to partner together to create a transition plan that is good for the church and that is formulated in conversation with presbytery leadership. In the EPC, we are blessed to have the covering and the protection and the wisdom of our presbytery leadership. And in this context, we're specifically talking about our ministerial committees. So once a pastor has identified that a transition is coming, whether that's departing to a new ministry call or going into retirement, they need to inform the session and the ministerial committee so that the ministerial committee can come alongside the session in creating a plan that is sound and healthy. And then finally, that third point, that third value we want to emphasize is clear communication. Transition is a very sensitive time in the life of a church. Feelings, emotions can run high. You know, anytime you go through grief and loss, there's going to be a greater sensitivity. And so we really need to strive for the utmost clarity in communication. And as you'll see, as we go through these guidelines a bit more, when all parties involved in transition are able to agree to a plan and go into the transition with shared expectations, then it's much less likely that problems are going to crop up along the way. You know, shared expectations are so important in any healthy relationship, but especially for a body of believers going through transition. And the sun setting just decided to make me glow. So I'm not Moses. This is not the Shekinah glory. This is called sunset in the Midwest. Sorry about that. I'm actually going to go off camera for a second to close my blinds so that I don't blind you. There we go. That's a little better. You can't pay for entertainment like this, right? So if you're following along in that packet that I emailed out, on page two, you'll see that there's a section entitled The Challenge. And here, we really just want to again acknowledge how difficult transition can be, how deep that sense of grief and loss can be when it's time for a pastor to move on from his or her call. And so it's important to acknowledge that, to be able to grieve our losses, to grieve the ending of what has been, while we at the same time strive to be open and welcoming toward the new work that the Lord is doing. And one of the most important ingredients in facing that challenge is the self-awareness of the departing pastor. Again, whether the pastor is going into retirement or simply moving on to take a new call, our prayer and our hope is that they would have the inward spiritual resources and the relational resources to be able to anticipate any potential problems that they're going to face in saying goodbye and being able to move on. And this is also true for the pastor's family, particularly pastor's spouses. This is where that intentionality comes in, really, really taking time to walk through a transition in a purposeful and proactive way. And we sincerely encourage our pastors who are contemplating retirement, especially, to spend some time either with a trusted friend, a counselor, or spiritual director to think ahead of time about where the pitfalls may lie for them. You know, everybody's got a different personality and a different temperament. Some folks may struggle in one area and some may struggle in a completely different way. But that self-awareness piece seems to be very important so that the pastor can go into this transition as an equal partner with the session in creating a transition plan that's healthy and that's oriented toward the best interests of the church. I listened recently to a podcast interview between two pastors who had gone through transition. One who had left his church completely after he stepped down from being senior pastor, and one who had stayed on in some capacity after his time as senior pastor ended. And they talked about the fact that that transition, stepping down from that senior leadership role, was the hardest thing they'd ever had to do in their lives. And that may be the case. If you're a pastor, saying goodbye, letting go so that the Lord can bring in the next pastor to lead the ministry, may be the hardest thing that you've ever had to do. And so we encourage you to seek the support and the help that you need to do that well and to work ahead of time to develop deep, deep foundation of trust in your relationship with God so that you know that your identity is not tied to being called pastor, but that your identity is firmly found in being a child of God. So those are some of the big picture paint strokes in terms of how we think about a healthy transition. Towards the bottom of our second page, we get into the specific guidelines for walking through a transition. And these guidelines are really oriented toward what we call a clean break. So a clean break would be where a pastor is going to leave their ministry position and no longer be involved in the life of the local church. So you can look there. There are some really specific numbered points there about the role of the session and the role of the pastor, and even the timetable for when a pastor would be able to re-engage with a congregation after a transition. But I want to highlight just a couple of things here. One is that once a pastor decides that he or she is going to be departing the church and they inform the session really needs to be in the driver's seat of the transition planning. The session needs to own that process for the health of the church because the session is responsible for the whole spiritual life of the church. And this certainly pertains to that. So again, the pastor, assuming that the pastor is the one initiating this process, the pastor informs the session. The session then really needs to come around the pastor and coalesce together to work again collaboratively to form a healthy transition plan. And they own that process. But the pastor continues to have a very important role in terms of taking the primary responsibility for articulating what's happening and explaining the boundaries that come with the transition. It doesn't feel really good to people if someone else tells them that their pastor is going to be leaving. If at all possible, when at all possible, it's much healthier for the congregation, for the pastor to be the one explaining that and working hand in glove with the session to make sure that everything is communicated very clearly to the congregation, including the staff. Some churches have a lot of staff, some have no staff. I would say if your church has staff, please don't forget them in communicating the transition plan. Sorry to say, sometimes staff end up being overlooked in these things, and boy, are they sure important in the success of a healthy transition. So one last thing I want to say about those specific guidelines is that, you know, even if you're going for a clean break, if the pastor really is going to move forward and no longer be involved in the ministry of the church, it's important to differentiate between the pastoral relationships that he or she has and the personal friendships. And especially if a pastor has been there for years and years, you know, 10, 20 years in the same congregation, Lord willing, they will have developed some very deep, vital relationships within the congregation. And we would never want someone to think they simply have to throw those away and leave them behind. What they need to do, and this is where, again, the intentionality comes from in the maturity, they need to find a way of disconnecting the personal relationships from the ministry relationship so that as they're engaging with friends, they're not being drawn into conversations about the church or, you know, the ministry of the new pastor or whatever it may be. But we certainly want to affirm the importance of the relationships that come with being a pastor. And again, for the pastor's family, there's enough grief and loss simply in changing the nature of relationship. We would never want someone to feel like they had to completely let go of those connections. Let's see, just a couple more really quick things, and then we're going to transition a little bit. Transition is the word of the night. One is that, you know, we've articulated some guidelines here that really pertain to a clean break scenario, but churches have found other ways of navigating transition well. There are churches that do succession planning, where the outgoing pastor is a part of preparing their successor. I've even heard of churches kind of doing a flip-flop between an associate pastor and a senior pastor, where now the senior pastor becomes an associate, and sometimes they even stair-step down the number of hours they work into retirement. So there are lots of different ways that a session might discern is best. But again, I would just say those same three values apply: intentionality, collaboration, and clear communication, so that everybody has a sense of the shared expectations and knows what the goal is. Finally, anytime we go through an ending and prepare for a new beginning, it's important for us to mark that occasion and to mark that transition. And so for churches thinking about going through a pastoral transition, we would encourage them, we would encourage the session particularly, to be mindful of ways that they can celebrate God's faithfulness through the life and the ministry of the outgoing pastor, even as they prepare to move forward. Symbolism in those times of transition can be very meaningful and important to God's people. We see that throughout scripture. So as much as we want to be careful to work collaboratively and communicate things clearly, we want to be sure that we take the time to look back and celebrate and give thanks for what God has done. Okay, just a couple more things here I want to highlight. Along with the guidelines here, we've also provided an example terms of separation agreement that may or may not be helpful to you if your church goes through transition. It's just kind of a boilerplate model so that you can have a conversation about how you want to navigate a transition. And then there is another resource at the very back, a list of books and podcasts that might be helpful to pastors, particularly who are contemplating retirement. So those are all resources that we would highly recommend, again, to help pastors be intentional and proactive in thinking about how to say goodbye and how to leave well. So with that, we are going to move to the second part of our webinar tonight. And I'm so thankful to be joined by two wonderful colleagues and friends of mine. We've got Fred Leon here and Joshua King. And these two gentlemen have had the privilege of having pastored the same congregation. Fred is the former pastor of Grace Point Community Church in Littleton, Colorado. And Josh is the current pastor of that same congregation. And so we thought it would be helpful to hear directly from some people who've gone through this process and have survived it and thrived through it. So I've got one question for each of them, and then we'd love to open it up to you all to hear any thoughts and questions you may have on this topic. So Fred, we're gonna start with you. You served Grace Point for how long was it? 25 years?
35 years.
35 years. Oh my goodness. So as you prepared to retire after 35 years with this congregation, share with us two or three guiding thoughts that really helped you navigate your departure.
Yeah, thanks, Annie. And thanks for giving us such a great foundation from which to speak about this topic. First, I just want to note that this may be the first time in the history of the EPC that we have a king and a queen participating together. So this is really, really exciting. So thank you all for being here. Let me give you some context. As Annie said, I was pastor at Grace Point Community Church for 35 years. And I also came in to a congregation whose founding pastor became my associate pastor. He was 66 and a half years old, so he was 3.5 years away from retirement. And he founded the church 18 years prior to that. So he had married, buried, and baptized a whole bunch of people. And he was a great pastor to them, but it was time for a transition. And so he and I spoke about this ahead of time, several times. Did we think it could work? How is it going to work? How are we going to blend our gifts and abilities and skills? And how are we going to differentiate in the job descriptions what we're going to do? And we started forward, and it did not work well for many reasons. I'm not going to go into all the specifics, but for us, it was not a healthy environment as Annie has been promoting. So I became the pastor, and in fact, this former pastor had led the church out of the PCUSA. So the bonding of the congregation with this former pastor was really, really tight. He took them through some extremely difficult times, spiritually, personally, financially. They lost their building, had to find a new facility. So he really was a visionary for them. And for me to step into that role, when I came to the church, about half the congregation left because I was the new pastor. When he retired 3.5 years later, another 50% left because they were really more affiliated with him. So I look at my ministry as having started about 5 years after I got there. It was a challenge. So now to answer your specific questions, and I'll be concise with this, Annie. The first thing that I would suggest, and that I really had to apply to myself over about a 25-year period, was to recognize that my identity was not as a pastor. My identity was as a child of God. Because as soon as I move out of the pastorate, you know, what do? I lose my identity, but I never lose my identity being a child of God. And I learned this truth early on, and coupled with that specific truth, about 15 years before I retired, and I retired in May of 2020, May 31st, 2020, right at the beginning of the pandemic, which was a great blessing for Josh to come in and provide leadership. But I learned about 15 years before that, I learned not to say my church or my congregation, the congregation that I pastor, the church that I pastor or a church that I lead. But I wanted to make sure that I didn't use words that reinforced my ownership of people or place. And that was really helpful also. The second thing was I began preparing the session and the congregation 5 years before my retirement date. And I did this through sermons and Bible studies. I was teaching regular communication with the session. 3 years before I retired, we established a strategic planning committee that would look at all the different facets of what needed to be investigated and evaluated, and what were the needs, and especially to reinforce, we don't want a clone of Fred. We want God's person in this position. And then the third thing I would say is my motto for those last 5 years was, I want to end well and I want to finish well. And I hope that I put as much effort into accomplishing that as I possibly could. The book that really helped me through this process was by Dr. Henry Cloud, Necessary Endings. Yeah, I think it's in the bibliography in the handout that that Annie sent to you. And in all of this, I'll tie it up with this. We've been focusing so much on the pastor. How's that transition? It's hard for the pastor, but don't forget the pastor's wife. That is as critical a relationship as it is with the pastor. The thing that helped me the most through my process was before I was a pastor, I was a marriage and family therapist. And then I was counseling lots of pastors over my 35 years of ministry who were going through this transition, difficult transition time. So listening to their challenges, listening to their heartache, listening to the victories as well as the so-called defeats that they were experiencing really helped me prepare my heart. So when that time came for me to say, thanks for the memories, I believe I was emotionally prepared to move on to the next chapter in my life. So thank you, Annie. And the best decision I ever made, he's going to be speaking to you right now.
That's great. That's a great lead-in. Thank you, Fred. So Josh, over to you now. We'd love to hear two or three thoughts or feelings you had as you prepared to lead Grace Point, knowing that Fred had been there for decades. What was that like on your side?
It was incredibly intimidating. I've said in my better moments, it's very humbling. And in my darker moments, it's just very intimidating to think about stepping in to a congregation where, you know, people have literally known this pastor for their entire lives, right? As their only pastor. You know, I've got an elder who this is literally the only church he's ever gone to. And Fred was the only pastor he's ever known. And so there's such a steep learning curve coming into that. There's these giant running shoes to fill. And I've this is my first running joke, Fred, maybe my last, but it's my first one. So I'm sneaking it in. And so what I wanted to say was the beauty of clarity that God gave me was my calling to Grace Point. I was not hired to replace Fred. I was not asked to become the next Fred. I was called by God to be the pastor of Grace Point Community Church. And so he's gifted me individually. He's called me specifically. And these crazy folks went ahead and made a contract out of that. And so now we've got a new relationship that is not juxtaposed to Fred. And so as long as I can have clarity about that and say, look, I serve my Lord Jesus, and they want me to serve my Lord Jesus. And this is the relationship they have. This is pastor. And I tell them, you're welcome for this. I am literally God's gift to them. Like I am Jesus's gift to the church, right? That's what he says, Pastor Ephesians, right? Yeah. So we're Jesus's gift to the church. And I mean that in a way that is supposed to remind us that the primary relationship we have is not a legacy. It's not an expectation. It is Jesus Christ. And he's the one that we serve. And if we do that faithfully, relying on him, he'll take care of the rest, right? So that's important for me to do. So again, if I have those moments, you know, I just look and go, okay, no, remember your calling. Remember your calling. You know, that's where that's at. Other thing I want to say, I don't know how you've personally responded to this idea that the pastor needs to make a clean break and that there needs to be this time of leaving. So I'll phrase it to you like this. If the pastor has done a good job, and Fred did, they have built deep relationships in that congregation. When they leave, there will be an enormous relational vacuum. Whoever comes in as the pastor cannot replace that because they don't have the history. They don't have the shared experience. They've never gone to battle together. They've not gone through the life change. So there's going to be a vacuum. If the pastor stays, well, then there's an almost magnetic attraction, right? If I can mix my metaphors, and they're going to go right back to the pastor every time when there's a problem in the family, when there's a crisis in the heart, you know, whatever it is. And so it is because the pastor leaves that they turn and say, okay, who has God given me to walk with me in this time, right? So there has to be that separation. And I think, I do think it's actually correlational to the length of time and the health of that pastoral relationship, right? If there was division and strife and that sort of thing, they're probably ready to cling to the next person. If this is a beloved pastor who's been there for 3.5 decades, it's going to take a while. It's going to take a long while. You know, and with all the best intentions, it's going to take a while. And so I would say expect that. And as you're prepping personally and your congregations understand, and Annie referenced this a little bit earlier, that all change is perceived as loss, right? And so even if this is a super positive, I'm retiring, it's been beautiful, here's somebody that I really think God has called here, and he's going to be a blessing to you. And that is our experience at Grace Point Community Church. There's still loss. There's still heartache. There's still hurt. And so we can anticipate the grief. You know, we just had a very dear member of the congregation graduate to be with Jesus, right? And we were all ecstatic for him. And we're all also just heartbroken, right? Mm. So both are true. And it's going to be true when the pastor leaves the congregation. And I'll say a third thing here, and then I'll hit my mute button, as you may be praying for. So what I want to say is this, every congregation, whether you know it or not, has things that they cling to as this is how we've always done it. This is really important to us. And even as much as you may come into this thinking we're ready for change, you're going to find some of those triggers, hot buttons, sacred cows, whatever you want to call it, that are going to get people to say, whoa, 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 that's not how Fred did it, or that's not what we've been doing. How come you're changing everything? So what I would think, if you're coaching your session, if you're coaching your staff, if you're coaching your congregation, please coach them to just have the response, the prepared response of, I know I'm going to disagree with the new pastor, and I'm going to support them. And I'm going to support them not by verbally assenting to what they're saying, but I'm actually going to participate and give my energy and my effort. And even if you're just giving them the gift of failure, you know what I mean? Right? It's truly a bad idea. It's going to fail. It'll never work. Give them 100% of your gift into that failure so you can learn together, right? And you can walk forward. But what you need is that relationship built more than you need the achievement of the program or the event or whatever. And so if you can just focus on nurturing that relationship at the beginning, that's going to pay dividends down the road.
Well said, Josh. Thank you so much. Along those lines, Fred, I want to go back to you real quick before we open it up. I remember when we presented this material at GA, you shared a little bit about what you had said to members of the congregation about moving forward. So when the new pastor comes and he's trying some things out, you had some boundaries about what you did and did not want to hear. Could you share that with us?
Yeah, I'll be happy to. So in my very last sermon, almost the very last words I said were, when Josh is now your pastor, and if you like his preaching more than my preaching, I want to hear about that. If you liked my preaching more than his preaching, I don't want to hear from you. I also said there are going to be changes made. And if you don't like those changes, you don't come to me. You go to Josh or you go to Session and you share your concerns. But I do not want to hear criticism. I do not want to hear anyone speaking disparagingly of your new pastor. And the other thing I did, because I still have friendships with many people in the congregation, but it's at a distance. Whenever I return an email to them, I never sign it Pastor Fred. I simply sign it Fred. So I let them know that I see my relationship with them as a friendship, not as their pastor anymore.
Thank you, Fred. Yeah, those little details really make a difference. They really communicate a lot in helping people be able to move forward in a God-honoring and a mature way. Absolutely. Well, let's go ahead and open it up. You've heard us share. You've had a chance to look at these guidelines in terms of how to navigate transition well. What are the thoughts and questions you have at this point as you think about what transition should look like?
I'm Keith. I just have a question of both Fred and Joshua. What's the time frame? Was Fred there all the way to the end and all of a sudden the next week Josh is in there? Or did you have an overlap at all? Or did you have an interim in there at all? Or how did that work?
Yeah, so Keith, what we ended up agreeing on was that we would do a 1 month transition. So I came on staff at the beginning of May. Because we're beautifully Presbyterian, we had already done all the work of Fred's retirement and my ordination into the office. In February's Presbytery, right? So I was a staff. I didn't even have a title, maybe staff pastor, I don't know. But I was on staff for the month of May. We shared some preaching duties. You got to know, we were just staring at a camera, basically, right? Because this is May of 2020. So Fred retired May 31st, and then I became the pastor June the 1st. So there were some drawn out things with the transition, but we really narrowed it down to, let's take a month. And I got to tell you, most of that month was just calling people in the church and talking with them on the phone, right? Because it was May of 2020.
Hmm. And in a sense, the pandemic was really a blessing in this transition because people could show up and there was already distance, March, April, May. The emotional distancing had already occurred just because of the pandemic. So in a sense, even though Josh had come in with that difficult situation, it probably was also helpful in making that transition for the congregation emotionally and relationally.
Brandon, I saw you'd had your hand up.
Yeah, I'm going to be negative temporarily. I'm a private investigator and my business helps churches investigate internal problems and conflicts. So this is all great. I am all for, you know, the failure, clear transition and whatnot. So my question for, I guess, both Mr. Lin and Mr. King, and also Ms. Annie, is what if it's not a clear break? What if it is a more aggressive separation with the pastor and the congregation?
So, Brandon, are you asking about a situation where it's not the pastor's choice to depart, but where they're asked to leave? Okay, understood. Yeah. Fred, would you like to tackle that? Just talking about nuances in that situation where it's not the pastor's choice to be moving on.
Thanks, Annie. Brand, that's a great question. So I've been chair of our ministerial committee like five different times over the years that I've been in the EPC, and have had to, unfortunately, oversee a lot of these really difficult situations that you're referencing right now. And each of them has their own uniquenesses and nuances. But I think what I would say now, because I have experience, but we also have new opportunities now, is to go the transitional pastor route first before calling a new pastor. That transitional pastor then has the opportunity to say the hard things that a brand new pastor coming in might be hesitant to say. Plus, the transitional pastor can be that sacrificial lamb and take a lot of the hurt and the pain and the anger and the frustration and all that comes with a difficult parting, and help that congregation move through it and begin the healing, recovering process before a new pastor, full-time pastor is called.
And I would add to that, just on the pastor side, I want to do a quick commercial and shout out here to our friends at PIR Ministries. PIR stands for Pastors in Residence. And Roy Yankee is an EPC ruling elder who is the executive director of that ministry. And they started out focusing on coming alongside pastors and families who had been exited from their churches. So I certainly hope that if a session or a ministerial committee is talking with a pastor who's being exited from their church and struggling with that, you know, PIR is a great resource to offer coaching and support and help the pastor and their family move forward.
Yeah, so some of the stuff that I do is obviously outside of the Presbyterian Church, because we have a really good, you know, system of handling that. And the PIR ministry is something that I have in my back pocket whenever I'm working with these churches to give them a call.
Wonderful. Other questions?
Thanks for all you do, Brandon. Appreciate that.
Absolutely. Yeah, other questions or interaction with the ideas here so far?
And this is Keith again. I know that we went to the transitional pastor thing at the General Assembly there, and they were really encouraging that up one side and down the other to have a break. And, you know, we've got our pastor who's been here for 12, 15 years, thereabouts, and everybody loves him right now, pretty much. And so there's not, but it still feels like a transitional pastor may be the way to go, even when you've got a good relationship.
So. Absolutely. I can't say enough how helpful I think transitional ministry can be. I served a congregation as an associate pastor when it went through a transition in the senior leadership position. And we were so blessed to welcome a trained transitional pastor. It's a really unique ministry, that time of goodbye and preparing for hello. Again, it's very sensitive and can be very tenuous depending on the personality of the congregation and what else is in their history. So I would strongly recommend that any church going through transition consider calling a transitional pastor, no matter if they think they're doing well or not. It's really helpful to prepare for the next new beginning. Any other lingering thoughts?
This is Jerry Dunlap.
Yes, Jerry.
Hello, Jerry Dunlap, Ruling Elder Covenant Church, Reno, Nevada. It's because we are very close personal friends with our pastor and his wife and family, we know that they will be retiring soon. He's been there. In fact, this fall will be his 25th anniversary. We just celebrated this last Sunday, the the vote that the church made to call him as pastor 25 years ago when we were part of the PCUSA. All of this is very helpful. I know he's making plans, and from the things we've heard, it sounds like they're planning on making a clean break, and they know that that means navigating the relationships. But all of us are grown-ups there, so we don't have much of a problem, but there's still the grief. And so I thank you for all of this. I've been, even though I know I don't need to, I still take notes to fill in the wonderful paperwork you've had here. And I don't think I have anything that I need to ask, because you guys seem to have answered it all, but I'll bet something will pop up in a few months. We're not sure when he's going to retire. It could be in the next couple of years, but we're preparing because we're kind of on the inside and we haven't talked to anybody. We figured that's his move.
Mm-hmm. That's wonderful, Jerry. I'm sure it's such a blessing to your pastor and his family to have your friendship. And thank you for taking the time to look into this and be prepared. By the way, I noticed the notes you were taking. Was that a pad of paper you got at another General Assembly years ago?
Renewed.
I thought that looked familiar.
And that way I can stick it right inside of my session folder, and it's there along with this document. And I did that at the last meeting. I frankly am thrilled to death with these Zoom meetings. We did fraternal relations in about 35 minutes because everything was handed to us on a silver platter, and we were able to read it and reread it. And then everybody that spoke answered all the questions, so there was no doubt. So this is very helpful for me. I love the interreaction. I love the fellowship and everything that we get to do at both presbyteries and general assemblies, but to handle important information where those of us that are almost 73 and cannot hear as well as other people get to hear very well instead of the din of the room causing us to lose a word. So I'm grateful for that as well. But yes, wonderful. That's what it is.
Jerry, you and I are definitely brothers in Christ.
Oh, do you got the same one?
I got the same one.
Hey, I have a question for you. You know those, have you seen those little blue the plastic packages that fold in half and they're for filling with pills? I got one of those a yes. number of years ago, and I loved it. So when we came back this year, they had more, and my wife and I grabbed more because it helps us at our age. We have to take a lot of pills. I'm sorry.
I put my M&Ms in those.
Yeah. Hey, and you can separate them by color if you're ADHD. Yeah, right.
I love it.
Am I going to have to investigate you?
That's yeah. right.
Well, yeah. All those pills. When I have sat down with other elders and people, I say, first of all, so you can understand me, I'm left-handed, which means I'm right-brained, which means I'm going to come through the different door than you came through. I'm ADHD. I'm sanguine melancholic. So there's going to be all sorts of things. I've been spending my whole life fighting these things because there were no drugs. And I thank God there were no drugs because he forced me to deal with it. And he taught me how to sit quiet in a room for a half an hour, which for somebody who's ADHD and right-brained is very hard. Anyway, that's my spiel.
So Jerry, I'm left-handed also, and I'm 73. So we have a lot.
Well, I'm really catching up.
Go Boomers! Go Boomers!
Well, this has just been such a delight to be together, and I thank you all for making time to join us. One quick thing before I ask Fred to close us in prayer. If you notice at the very end of your document, there were a couple QR codes. One of those QR codes gives you access to this document electronically. That's not as important for you because I already emailed you the link. But the other QR code is a link to a survey. If you would be willing to give us some feedback on this session and on the material and the guidelines, we would sure appreciate it. Again, I think I mentioned at the start, the Ministerial Vocation Committee is continuing to revisit these guidelines. We want to improve them and make them as helpful as we can for our churches and leaders. So we'd appreciate hearing from you. All right, Fred, if you could close us in prayer, that would be great.
Okay. And again, thank you, each one of you, for participating in this. You are a blessing to us. Thank you. Lord Jesus, we do give you praise for who you are, first and foremost, a good and gracious and loving God. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for the very breath of life you've given us. And we pray, Father, that in all that we do and say and think, that in our attitudes, Lord, that we would represent you well in every encounter that we have in life. So, Father, we pray that you will go before us, you'll protect us on every side, you'll have our back, and Lord, that your name will be honored and glorified through each of our lives, so that when you return, there will be great acclamation in recognizing who you are, because your gospel message has been proclaimed faithfully. We give you praise and thanksgiving, and it's in your name I pray. Amen.